evening, Tuesday, November 22nd, 2016, a very cool, frosty morning in Florida, which we very much needed. And I want to thank and congratulate all the new commissioners and welcome this morning, all of you. Seniors.
I'm a senior now. That's good.
This is a different board. It's going to be really neat. This morning we have Dr. Kennedy, which we had service with earlier. If you would come to the podium, he'll give our invocation. Our Pledge of Allegiance will be led by Commissioner Harvey. Everyone would stand, please.
Thank you. You know, as we join together in prayer and pray for our country, our state, and our county, we're reminded of the very symbols of our great nation, which the Pledge of Allegiance, we focus under one nation under God. The currency that we actually put in our pockets says, in God we trust. And he's the one that we focus our attention on. In Amos 4:13, it says, he who forms the mountains, creates the wind, reveals his thoughts to man. He who turns the dawn to darkness and treads the high places of the earth, the Lord Almighty is his name. Would you join me as we pray to him? Father, thank you so much for the opportunity we have once again to come together and to focus our attention upon the needs and the concerns and the issues in our community. Father, we pray for this county commission. We pray for all the staff of our county. We ask that you would continue to guide them and direct them, encourage them. Father, strengthen them, give them wisdom. We also pray that you would embrace not only them, but their families, protect them, Father. And as they continue to serve this county, we pray that they would focus their attention upon your wisdom, and that, God, they would be very discerning, they'd be very fair and just, and, Father, seek the very best for our great community. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Join me in the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Dr. Kennedy, I want to congratulate you on your healing process. You look like your old self again, and for that, we're very thankful, sir. Thank you for being here today. Okay, commissioners, in front of you have the minutes from the November 8th, 2016 meeting. I will entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move approval of the minutes.
Motion on the floor.
Second.
Second. Y'all be a little faster now today. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, like sign. Thank you, gentlemen. All right. I would like to remind everybody, if public comment is coming up, first we're going to have the election of a chairman, but you don't have to fill out these blue cards, but you will find them in the corridors, in the back of the room, and they are helpful if you'd like to comment at public comment. Tony's steadily bringing them to us. Okay. This time I'm looking for a moderator to take the floor. Is that you? Mr. Leary, are you the moderator this morning?
I'd be privileged to do that, sir.
Well, I'm going to give the floor over to you, sir. It's about that time. I'm ready to get out of this chair.
All right. Well, thank you. This is the time when the board conducts an organizational meeting to elect its chairman and vice chairman to serve for the next 12 months. It shall be the duties and responsibilities of the chairman to preside at the meetings of the board, to be the official signatory on documents, official documents approved for signature by the board, and to represent the board and the county at official functions. So the process that we will follow this morning will be that I will open the floor for nominations. Nominations do not necessarily require a second. After the nominations have been put in place, I will ask for a motion to close the nominations, and once we get a motion and a second to that motion, then we will proceed with the election of the chairman. So, do we have any questions about how we will proceed? All right, if not, I will open the floor for nominations for chairman for the coming 12 months.
I'd like to nominate Commissioner Harvey.
Mr. Goddard, bring that.
All right, we have Commissioner Harvey's name in nomination.
Yes.
Are there any other nominations? If there are no other nominations, it would be appropriate for a member of the board to offer a motion to close the nominations and to elect Commissioner Harvey by acclamation.
Well, then I'll close.
All right, have a motion to that effect. Is there a second?
Second.
Motion and second. Any further discussion? There being no further discussion, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 All right, congratulations, Commissioner Harvey. You are chairman.
Told you I want out of the chair.
Woo.
I'm gone.
Thank you, sir. If we can do everything that quick.
No.
All right.
Mr. Chairman, would you like me to proceed with the election of the vice chairman?
Sir. Right.
Thank you. We'll follow the same process for the election of the vice chairman. We'll now receive nominations for vice chairman for coming 12 months.
I'll make the motion to nominate Chip Leibel.
I have Commissioner Leibel's name in nomination for vice chair. Are there any other nominations?
Mr. Moderator and Commissioner Pickens, I thankfully decline. I'd like to see some of our new commissioners positioned to this seat. And Mr. Goddard, would you accept it?
Yes.
I would like to elect Mr. Goddard. Nominate Mr. Goddard into that position.
All right, Commissioner.
Thank you, Mr. Pickens. But I've been chairman numerous times, and I'd like to see the board grow. And I think that putting the pressure on you guys to get in these seats will get you up to speed a little faster. So thank you very much.
All right. So we have Commissioner Leibel having declined and Commissioner Goddard's name placed in nomination. Do we have any other nominations? If not, it would be
appropriate. Motion to close.
All right, motion to close and to elect Commissioner Goddard by acclamation as vice chairman. Is there a second to that?
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? If not, all in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 That's unanimous, and congratulations.
All right. Thank you.
Well, good morning. It's exciting to be here today. Thank you, fellow commissioners, for the confidence you placed in me, and I look forward to serving this year. And I'm just we can't talk privately, but we can talk publicly, and anything I can do to help you, please feel free to do that. We have a fine staff here that will help you in anything you need to do. All you just need to do is ask the questions, and they will give you the best answers. Now we'll move into our next item on the agenda is our public comment. And we got to learn how to work this thing.
Okay. Larry, in the past, we let your vice chair do that.
Okay.
Let you
well, vice chair
concentrate.
Very good. Yeah, you can figure this out. We give them 3 minutes.
We can do that.
Yeah.
And let everybody just.
All right, our first speaker will be Brian Bergen from the Chamber of Commerce. Mr. Bergen, if you'll come up. You know what, I don't think it's on. There we go. Again, you don't need to have a blue card to speak, so please just feel free after we're done with the blue cards. If you have something to say, we'll be glad to entertain
Mr.
that.
Mr. Chairman, I actually like to hold my comments for when FPL is doing their presentation.
I'm sorry, I didn't see that. You're exactly right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Howard, well, that's also, and Debbie Griffin, and let's see, Faye Sparkman, you're up next. And I'm in trouble because I didn't wear my pin today. I do apologize. So. Yeah.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I would like to thank all of you for running a very clean campaign. And the funny part was, in the West End, we got most of you that are new to come out and speak. And I remember calling Mr. Pickens, and I think he was actually scared. When we got there, he found out we're real pretty nice people in the West End. The next person I had called was Tommy Stillwell, and he's like, Where is it exactly? So he'll learn the whole county now. And then we came to Buddy, and he's a trip. So, and I think you all do a great job, and the best part is you have to remember you're countywide county commissioners. So if one of us should call you from the West End, you need to come. The same thing out here, they'd have to go to the South End. But anyway, congratulations and have fun.
Thank you, Ms. Bartman, thank you. Would anybody else in the audience like to speak? Please come up, state your name and address.
Good morning, my name is Wanda Ruckowitz. I live at 106 Taylor Street in Interlochen, Florida. I'm just here on behalf of the QI Roberts Junior Senior High School Band and Chorus. We will be having our annual Christmas fundraiser, which is December the 5th, and everybody got an invitation. And if you could come, it starts at 6, and it's going to be a country hoedown Christmas. So if everybody could come, we'd really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. I guess jeans and boots are in order, correct? Good deal, good deal. Well, thank you. Anybody else in the audience that would like to speak at this public comment? All right, seeing none, we'll move on to the next agenda. We have Weiwei with FDOT, and she's going to be here talking to us about the I-75 relief meetings that they've been having throughout the state of Florida. You have as much time as you need. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good morning, new and senior commissioners. Thank you so much for this opportunity to talk to you about the I-75 Relief Task Force recommendations. Commissioner Harvey asked me to come over and talk to you about what the I-75 Relief Task Force has decided, has recommended to DOT Secretary, and what is DOT doing to implement these recommendations.
Wait, if you'll hang on just a minute. Guys, if you can look at your monitor right here, that'll give you her presentation. Thank you. Go right ahead.
My name is Weiwei Shen. I'm the manager of Systems Planning Office at DOT in Tallahassee. I was the project manager for the I-75 Relief Task Force. The task force was established by DOT Secretary Jim Boxholt in October 2015 with very broad memberships from the initial six focus counties west of I-75. Secretary Boxholt asked the task force to come up with transportation options to improve existing facilities or develop new transportation facilities within the initial study area to provide relief to I-75 and also in the longer term, enhance regional connectivity between Tampa and Jacksonville. The task force has submitted their recommendations to Secretary Boxholt by October 1st, 2016. The task force final report is posted on the task force website in its entirety. It's a pretty short document. Technical difficulties. While we're working out how to advance the slides, where we are in the transportation planning process with the task force work, what I wanted to bring to your attention is that we're very early on in the transportation planning process. If you look at this slide, toward the right-hand side, you see the project development process. That's when DOT work with members of the public to evaluate the feasibility of different specific transportation alternatives. The task force process is a step that we've added on to the very beginning of the process so we can have some consensus recommendations, very high level recommendations as to where we need to focus our resources, how should we conduct our evaluations. Where we are right now is that we've got the task force recommendations, we're in the process of implementing their recommendations, taking a look, conducting evaluation studies. All right, it's It's working now. The task force has conducted 7 task force meetings, several agency coordination meetings with local and regional agencies. We had a series of public open houses, and on our website, we have continuous opportunities for public to provide their comments to the task force, and we've shared all the public comments with the task force. Commissioner Harvey was at several of our open houses, and we've received, although Putnam County is not within the 6 initial focus county area because of its geographic location right next to I-75 in this key area, we've received hundreds of written comments from Putnam County residents throughout the task force process. We have all these comments documented. Early on during the task force process, they've adopted the 4C framework that was developed by the How Shall We Grow process in the Orlando area. What they did was organizing their guiding principles by conservation, countryside, centers and communities, and corridors. These 20 guiding principles that the task force had consensus on balances the 4C interests and considerations and would provide a very solid framework for DOT once we move forward in developing and evaluating transportation options to relieve I-75 and also provide connectivity for the larger study area. And we've also worked with the members of the public and agencies to identify areas with the highest concentration of environmental and community resources. If you see this land suitability map, basically the red areas are sort of the areas of avoidance when we design and implement our transportation infrastructure options. We need to avoid these sensitive areas, and we've also identified areas of avoidance and minimization. With the land suitability mapping, we've involved the members of the public and the agencies in the process, working together with the task force. So the task force recommendations has 3 key components. The first is that they wanted DOT to immediately optimize existing transportation corridors within the study area to implement strategies to improve the efficiency of existing corridors. And then these are more short-term strategies, and in the medium term, they want us to evaluate potential enhancements to or transformation of existing transportation corridors. Some examples of these strategies could include truck-only lanes, managed lanes on I-75 to make sure that traffic flows more efficiently. And then the task force also wanted DOT to evaluate potential areas of opportunity for new multimodal, multi-use corridors after we've done the evaluations of how to improve existing corridors, and we still see a need for new corridors. So these are the 3 key pieces of the recommendation. So what DOT is doing right now to evaluate their recommendations is we have this framework of options. We're going to continue to implement a robust public involvement process as we move from very broad level concepts into more specific alternatives. We're going to drill down more and come to the communities to make sure that the residents tell us their views about what we need to do in their area. And we're going to evaluate enhancements to I-75. And also we're taking a look at these parallel facilities that would potentially provide relief to I-75 in the process, how to improve these existing facilities. And also we're going to work with our partners to evaluate enhancements to intercity bus, passenger rail, and freight rail services. I think the task force was very adamant about, you know, DOT needed to take a look at the rail options. And what we're doing is we're going to conduct evaluation studies of potential areas of opportunity for new multimodal, multi-use corridors after we've evaluated the feasibility of strategies to improve existing facilities. That's what the task force wanted DOT to do. So Right now, my team and I were focused on a study called the North I-75 Master Plan. The focus of the study is to take a look at this broad area to see if we can work with county and local staff, work with the members of public to develop some strategies to improve existing facilities. What should we do for I-75, and what can we do to these core parallel facilities to provide relief to I-75? We've already started some of the shorter term solutions, discussing some of the shorter term solutions, like maybe having road ranger on in Alachua, on I-75 in Alachua and Marion counties, so we can clear incidents faster and better. And we're also looking into the potential of beefing up incident response services in this area. So these are some of the immediate action items that we're taking a look at. But a bit longer term, we want to work with you to identify strategies to improve existing transportation facilities within your area. And we're going to make sure that these potential improvements that we recommend are consistent with your local plans and with your local visions. I-75, you know, our initial evaluation sort of told us that the primary causes of congestion on I-75 are not caused by one factor. We have these special events and seasonal events that contribute to 30% of the congestion on I-75, and followed by incidents and bottlenecks. So some of the I-75 congestion and safety issues are happening on a non-recurring basis. If you look at the average daily traffic, it looks sort of okay, but when you have a football game at UF, during Thanksgiving season, the facility breaks down. So we're looking into different causes of the congestion and safety issues on I-75 and trying to come up with some innovative approaches that would address both the recurring and the non-recurring congestion on 75, so we can the traffic would flow smoothly and we improve safety on this facility. So the study process is that we're going to evaluate capacity improvements and how to maximize existing corridors, I-75 and alternative parallel routes, including US 301, 41, and 441, looking at both recurring and non-recurring congestion and make sure any recommendations that we have are consistent with comprehensive plans. And we're also going to have an initial broad brush evaluation of the impacts to social, natural, cultural, and physical environment. And also the cost of the project is also going to be taken into consideration. Some of these existing facility improvement strategies take a bit longer than what we expect to implement. If truck-only lanes is a viable option, it takes 10, 12 years at least to kind of have that sort of facilities implemented here. We're also going to coordinate with Federal Railroad Administration on their multi-state rail planning study to identify any passenger rail opportunities within the state, and also do a feasibility analysis of what can we do to enhance passenger and freight service and also intercity transit services within the study area. And we have to work with the rail industry to develop some of these recommendations. And of course, coordination with local governments and the members of the public is always paramount in whatever DOT does in developing our transportation alternatives. We've started initial data analysis, collection, and development in August 2016. Right now, we're still focused on data collection and analysis. We're conducting a series of meetings with county and MPO staff within the area to pick their brains, to get their ideas. We actually meet with them and have a map out and let them tell us where they have congestion and safety issues, what are some of the alternatives that they would recommend for DOT to take a look at. We will come up with conceptual alternatives by February 2017, and then we'll have a series of public workshops, maybe March 2017 to work with the community members to show them what ideas we have and see how viable they are listening to the members of public to tell us what they think. So stay tuned. We'll have announcements of our public meetings in March of 2017. But in the meantime, between now and then, my staff and I were available to take notes of any ideas that you have. We'll work with you, work with your staff, work with your civic organization members. Wherever you want us to be, we'll come and talk to you and listen to your ideas. So here's the, Jennifer Fortunas is the project manager for the North I-75 master plan, and she's working with our team to develop these transportation alternatives. You can either contact her or me if you want us to come speak or if you have any ideas that you would like to share with us. So this is my presentation, and thank you so much for the time, and I'd be happy to answer any questions, and our team can take notes of any ideas you have.
Commissioner Lible? Mrs. Shin, you mentioned just briefly the natural element to this acquisitions going along, but we have the Florida Wildlife Corridor that has been being established for about a decade now. Have you had any contact that you're aware of with this group? They're primarily providing a corridor for wildlife to go from the Everglades National Forest all the way to the Okefenokee Swamp in Georgia, and you're right in the middle of it with this concept.
We have two task force members representing the environmental stakeholders. So we're working with the wildlife corridor representatives in mapping these out. Yes, when we plan transportation corridors, the protection of wildlife corridor is not an afterthought. It's a corridor planning. We do it from the get-go. So we're mapping out these areas with our environmental stakeholders.
Okay, I just didn't hear mention of it, and it concerned me, but thank you. You answered my question.
Any other commissioners have any comment? Okay. If you'll hang on and just back up just a little, Mr. Tim Hotellin would like to ask a question concerning your presentation. And thank you, Weiwei, for that. You did a great job. Good morning, Mr. Hotellin.
Good morning. Tim Hotellin from San Mateo, 105 Riverside Way. I'm curious how many of these recommendations involve toll roads, managed lanes or toll roads, and the impact on that with Putnam County.
Good question. All right.
Great question. Right now, the I-75 master plan, we're focused on improving existing corridors, so we're not developing any new transportation alternatives for new toll roads. But when we develop managed lanes on I-75 and the sort of the medium term tolled managed lanes will be considered. It's just one of the options.
Okay, thank you. So all the options are on the table right now, and you're gathering as much information as you can from the public to make this decision.
Yeah, we will, when we add new facilities to a new capacity to the interstate, we'll conduct an analysis to see if toll lanes make sense. It's not from a revenue perspective, from an operational perspective, it makes sense, we'll implement toll lanes. If not, we'll add general lanes.
All right, well, thank you so much for coming to Putnam County, and we greatly appreciate it, you and your staff, and we'll look forward to working with you in the future.
Thank you.
Thank you. Gentlemen, we're going to take a 5-minute recess. Non? We'll call our meeting back to order, and commissioners, the consent agenda. Is there any items you would like to pull and discuss?
Mr. Chairman, I have none this morning.
Thank you. Mr. Goddard?
None.
Stillwell? Mr. Pickens? All right. The chair will entertain a motion to accept the consent agenda.
So moved.
All right. We have a proper motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Like sign. Motion carries. Consent agenda. Next case, codes enforcement. Mr. John Salmon. Request for abatement. request for abatement. Mr. Samuel, we can't hear you on that microphone.
Hello?
There you are. Can you get that closer to you?
I can have to restart the computer here in a second. And
okay.
I'll be right with you.
While we are taking some time, I would like to recognize Commissioner Nancy Harris is in the audience. Commissioner Harris, good morning to you. Commissioner Walton Palacir, he's also in the back there. Good morning to you, sir. I believe Carl Flagg was here earlier. Commissioner Flagg.
Sheriff-elect, too, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, I'm sorry, Sheriff-elect. Yes. Gator DeLoach is in the front row. Good morning to you, sir. Thank you.
Linda Myers is also.
Linda Myers, the Honorable Linda Myers, you're right. Any other elected people? No? Nope. Good.
You're stepping into minefield now. You can't forget one.
I know. I have a direct shot to Linda, and I just, sorry about that.
Okay, we're set.
All right.
This case is at 133 San Jan. John Ross Kinney is the owner. We're requesting to foreclose and abate. I won't go through the whole litany here, but we've been dealing with a care of premise issue on this back since 2013. On July 14, 2015, we received a call about a sunken boat, obviously it was there. There's a part of a picture of it there. I'll go there. That's what the hull looks like. We've gotten lots of complaints. Chip and Larry, I think, are quite familiar with the complaints because all the commissioners were getting complaints about this as well. This is the property itself. This is a very nice neighborhood. We went through all the legal processes to try and get Mr. Kinney to cooperate. Finally, on November 3rd, 2016, we went before the special magistrate, and he recommended that we authorize foreclosure and or abatement. Staff is requesting that we actually do both in this particular case. We have not foreclosed on a property since 2006, but this is a property that's in a very nice neighborhood on a canal, and we can get some of our money back that we've done, and we can maybe get this property in the hands of somebody that will actually take care of it. So today we're requesting the ability to foreclose and or abate.
All right.
Mr. Chairman, if I could get Mr. Sammons, for the benefit of the new commissioners, if you could explain what our goal, our objective is here as far as, you know, taxpayers' money will be required, commissioners, to pull. This is obviously a lot of money to remove this this boat. Yes. And we do, the planning department has a plan. If you could just kind of tell them how you will treat the situation, it would be helpful for
basically
them.
We send it out for bids. We'll get three or more bids in this case it's probably going to be a twofold bid because the people that will do the land clean up the property itself probably are not going to be the people that do the boat, so we'll have to hire two contractors to get both of those taken care of. It becomes a lien on the property, and that's what we do if we foreclose the lien. There's already a fine and a lien running for the care of premises on the land from the 2013 case. And then if we do end up foreclosing on it, we will try to get as much of that money back as we can. And our minimum bid is what our hard costs are for the abatements and the actual process that we go through to get there. So, and then any extra that we might get in the daily fine stuff will go back into the coffers of the general fund.
Good deal. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Lott. Any other commissioners have any questions or comments? Any of the public here to wish to speak on this case? Seeing none, Chairman will entertain a motion.
Well, move approval, staff recommendations.
Okay. All right, we have a proper motion. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
All right, all in favor say aye. Aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Thank you, Mr. Salmon.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, we have a 10 o'clock certain meeting with a planning and development PUD. So we will recess the meeting for 14 minutes and wait for our 10 o'clock to be. Call our meeting back together, and the next item on our agenda is our 10 o'clock certain. It's 10 o'clock, planning development, PUD 16004. Our attorney Stacy is going to give us some highlights real quick that you can go by.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just for the new commissioners coming in. When we have a quasi-judicial hearing, it is a public hearing where it's a little more formal than some of the other public hearings. In these types of matters, the applicant has an opportunity, and the staff and other interested parties have an opportunity to present evidence. And as this board, sitting as this board, will take that evidence into consideration and make a determination if the applicant is entitled to what it is that they are requesting per our county codes. If they meet all of the criteria, then the board makes findings that those criteria are met and they are entitled to that which they are requesting. As part of quasi-judicial matters, every member of the board, I will be asking you to put on the record any ex parte communications that you may have had with any of the parties, and by parties I mean the applicant. The county is a party being presented by county staff, as well as any interested parties, which are folks that would have direct impact by what is being proposed by the applicant. Is there any questions you all may have on that?
Okay, other than us passing out robes, we can move forward here.
Before we do then, I would like to put on the record, I was provided a list of ex parte communications by FPL, and I just want to go ahead and put that on the record, and I will provide a copy of this to the clerk, and then I will follow up by asking each one of you if you've had any individuals. Yes.
Yes, I'm not sure that I'm understanding it. Now, I was talked to a man yesterday that brought me some information about this is the Florida Power Light Solar issue, and that just showed all the assets and all the positive things about it. Didn't really get to read through it, but I believe it was a retired employee of FPL. So I'm just want to make sure that I'm doing the right thing by bringing that up.
That would be exactly right. That would be an ex parte communication.
I didn't get to read through it. I was busy, but he left it with me. I did look through some of it.
And if you receive written correspondence such as that, then what you can do is state on the record that you had this ex parte communication, and that it was a written communication, and then provide a copy of that to the clerk for the official record on the proceedings.
Okay, so that paper that the individual handed me, I should just bring it?
Yes, you can provide that to the clerk.
All right, very good.
Okay. So if I might, the memorandum provided by FPL is, the purpose of this memorandum is to summarize the ex parte communications between Florida Power and Light Company representatives and the Putnam County Board of County Commissioners regarding the FPL Horizon 74.5 megawatt photovoltaic solar facility PUD, PUD 16-004, rezoning the project, consistent with Putnam County Land Development Code Section 12.07.02J. Below is a summary of communications. On June 10th, 2016, Jim Bush with FPL met with Commissioner Leibel to provide an overview of the project and the Coral Farms Solar Project. The overview included showing the project and Coral Farms project on a map, discussing the benefits of solar and the potential benefits to the county. On July 6, 2016, it was Hawthorne Open House. Both Commissioner Harvey and Pellissier were in attendance. Jim Bush and FPL provided both with a quick overview of the project and the Coral Farms solar project. On July 11, 2016, Jim Bush with FPL follow-up meeting with Commissioner Harvey. The overview included showing the project and the Coral Farms solar project on a map, discussing the benefits of solar and the potential benefits to the county. July 21st, 2016, Jim Bush with FPL met with Commissioner Flagg to provide an overview of both the project and the Coral Farms solar project in Putnam County. The overview included showing both projects on a map, discussing the benefits of solar and the potential benefits to the county. September 21st, 2016, QI Roberts open house. Both Commissioner Harvey and Flagg were in attendance. Jim Bush with FPL discussed the project and the Coral Farms solar project with them. Their primary concern was feedback that we were receiving from the community. On September 26, 2016, Jim Bush with FPL met with Commissioner Flagg and a landowner who asked for additional information on the impact to local landowners. Topics discussed include visibility of the site, buffering, and the location of the substation and transmission. November 2nd, 2016, Jeff Beck and Jim Bush, both with FPL, met with Lake Winnet residents to discuss concerns over the project main entrance. Items discussed were the landowner concerns with the location of the front entrance, fencing, and wetland mitigation. Commissioner Harvey was also in attendance. November 19, 2016, Jim Bush with FPL met with Commissioner-elect Goddard to provide an overview of the project. The overview included showing the project on a map, discussing the benefits of solar and the potential benefits to the county. And finally, on November 21st, Jim Bush with FPL met with Commissioner-elect Pickens to provide an overview of the project. The overview included showing the project on a map, discussing the benefits of solar and the potential benefits to the county. And at this time, I would ask any of the commissioners if there are any additional ex parte communications you have had, and if you could put them on the record, please.
Yes, I have. At the meeting with Jim Bush was also Mike Garman from Florida Power and Light, and Dana Jones, president of the chamber, was also there. And if you're talking about county staff, I did talk to Rick Leary yesterday and Brian Hammonds, and they answered some questions for me also.
Commissioners, if you'll hold the microphone right to your, so we can get all that on tape. Thank you. Commissioner Stillwell?
No, the only conversation I've had with it was an individual coming by my business, and then of course we had the overlook of the whole packet yesterday with us, Mr. Leary. That's all the conversation I've had about it.
Thank you.
Yeah. Now I have spoke with Rick Leary and I spoke with Howard Griffin.
Commissioner Lowell?
No more than what you had mentioned, Council. The overview with Mr. Bush a while back is all of the communications I've had.
And I've had quite a few, but you've mentioned them. Also provided you with a list of the people that were out at the Melrose site on the side of the road that day, and also written correspondence. You've been provided that for, too.
And I will provide that to the clerk for the record.
Thank you. All right. The next introduction of petition. We've done that. Staff presentation.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir. Thank
Board of
you.
County Commissioners. Mike Brown, Planning Manager, Putnam County Planning and Development Services. The application before you today is PUD 16-004. The applicant is Florida Power and Light Company. Agent for the applicant is Joshua Long with the Gunster Law Firm. The request is to rezone 270.7 plus minus acres from agriculture to planned unit development. The purpose of the request is to facilitate the development of a 74.5 megawatt photovoltaic solar facility. Location of the project is the west side of Price Road, approximately 2.5 miles south of State Road 26, west of State Road 21, along the Putnam-Alachua County boundary. There's a general location map for your information. A little background on the project itself. Just point out, this is the second photovoltaic solar facility that FPL has submitted for rezoning. The first one was approved by the Board of County Commissioners, I believe it was October. This is their second effort in the county. Just a background, the photovoltaic solar panels will convert the sunlight into electricity, which will then be distributed to an on-site substation and then onto the grid. The facility will be unmanned when it's in operation. The project site is undeveloped and has been used for agricultural purposes in the past. The future land use designation on the property is Ag 2, and the zoning is agriculture. The project was reviewed by the Development Review Committee in October, and the Planning Commission reviewed the project at its November 9th meeting. There's a map showing the land use of the site and surrounding areas, the existing zoning, and this is a site layout of the project. I just want to point out one point here, and I will touch on it later. If you look on the right end, which would be east end of the project, there's a circle, a red circle. Within that circle, that is where the substation and, more importantly, the new entrance to the site is going to be. And I will touch on that a little later. One of the things we look at as we go in for rezonings is consistency with the adopted comprehensive plan. Policy A193A10D of the comp plan permits passive energy operation projects, both solar and wind, in agricultural to future land use with the approval of a PUD. This was a change that the county commission put into the comp plan specifically in their during their 2010 air-based amendments. Policy A193B5 of the comp plan allows PUD zoning in any future land use designation, as long as the PUD is consistent with the goals, objectives, and policies of the comp plan, meets the criteria of the Land Development Code, and does not increase the intensity or density of uses of the underlying land use category. And policy A174 allows new electrical substations in all future land use categories except within conservation, future land use category. Staff analysis is that the subject property is located on a land designated A2 on the adopted future land use map. The Ag 2 future land use allows passive energy solar generation projects subject to be PUD approval. The proposed PUD zoning is allowed in the A2 future land use, and the proposed PUD does not increase the intensity or density of uses over what is allowed in the A2 land use category. The proposed solar facility is consistent with the land use designation. Within the Land Development Code, the PUD, there is planned unit development criteria and requirements. Section 402.02a of the Land Development Code requires an application for rezoning to PUD to present evidence that the rezoning is justified by one or more of the following. And I'll quickly touch base on those. Although the project does not fit within an existing zoning district, it is consistent with the comp plan and the land use designation. And that does allow the PUD. The proposed development is of such size, complexity, and or unique design that it would be inconvenient or inefficient to process the proposal outside of the PUD process. And finally, the nature of the proposed use at the specific site requires special design characteristics to address environmental concerns and is consistent with the comprehensive plan policies. Staff finds that the proposed solar facility is unique and does not fit well within the existing zoning district. The agriculture 2 future land use category allows for passive energy passive energy generation projects subject to PUD zoning, and the applicant has provide, or the application does provide evidence that the rezoning to PUD is justified. The Land Development Code further states that if the application is justified for the PUD, that there are 8 criteria that have to be met. And I'll quickly touch base on each of these 8 criteria. Criteria 1, the density or intensity and character type of the proposed in the development plan is consistent with the comp plan, the future land use map, concurrency management, and the development plan meets the objectives of 40201B. Staff finds that the development of the passive energy solar energy facility is allowed in the A2, or agriculture 2 land use. The type of development is consistent with the county comp plan. The proposed development plan provides flexibility to meet changing needs, technologies, by providing clean energy source for consumers and reducing greenhouse gases. Criteria 2, the use proposed in the PUD are compatible with the terrain and existing and planned uses of the properties surrounding the PUD. Staff's response is that the proposed solar facility is a low impact use of the site that is compatible with the surrounding agricultural uses. The solar panels do not produce any sound. The project will produce no odors or other nuisances. Once construction is completed, the only traffic will be from maintenance personnel. Next criteria, residential density. The PUD must comply with density limitations in the land use category. There's no residential component to this project, so that is inapplicable. The next criteria relates to usable open space within the PUD. Staff finds that all structures and improvements on the site will be set back 25 feet from any wetlands. Security fencing will be in place adjacent to the solar panels to enhance wildlife movement. I will touch on that. That was a stipulation that came out of the Planning Commission, and I will get into that a little later in a little more detail. The site of the PUD must be suitable for use in a manner proposed without hazards to personnel either on or off site from the likelihood of increased flooding, erosion, or other dangers. The project has been designed and will be developed in accordance with a stormwater permit from the Florida Department of Environmental Protection, which will protect adjacent properties from runoff and should improve existing flooding problems on Price Road that is experienced out there today. Next criteria, all uses permitted in the PUD shall have access to public street, either directly or by private road. The project site will be accessed by a single entrance off of Price Road. The facility will be unmanned, and the project will be generate limited traffic once development is completed. The next criteria is sufficient off-street parking, on-street parking for bicycles, automobiles, etc. There's no need for off-street or on-street parking resulting from the project. The facility is designed to be unmanned. During construction phase, deliveries and construction personnel will park within the project boundaries. So there's no need, to connect to sidewalks or greenways or trails because it's an unmanned facility. Final criteria, utilities and essential public services, including but not limited to sanitary sewer, potable water, fire service, solid waste, and other services must be available and have capacity to serve the development. The facility will be unmanned, therefore there is no need for utilities or essential public services for the site. As part of the planned unit development, there is an agreement associated with this project and every PUD, and that agreement lays out the restrictions that will be placed on the developer and the land for the project. That provides protection, a lot of protection for the county. We know what is going to happen out there. That's one of the unique things and benefits of a planned unit development. Whereas in a regular rezoning district, there's a myriad of things that could happen, uses within that zoning category, but in PUD, it has specific requirements, so we know what this project will be. Let me just hit some of the highlights of the PUD agreement. The project will be developed as a single phase of development, required to begin within 24 months of the adoption of the PUD ordinance by the Board of County Commissioners if you choose to adopt it. The project will be developed consistent with the conceptual site layout, which I showed you earlier. FPL is required to maintain Price Road, and this was a change that came out of the Planning Commission. FPL is required to maintain Price Road from the Putnam-Alachua County line to the intersection with State Road 21. And FPL is required to bring Price Road back up to pre-construction conditions within 4 months after construction is completed. This will be coordinated with the Department of Public Works, and Public Works will have to sign off and agree that they've met that condition. Another change out of the Planning Commission is that there will be a single entrance located at the site of the substation on Price Road. The original entrance was at the intersection of Baker's Acres Road and Price Road. Neighbors out there had some concern with that. FPL has agreed to relocate that entrance to the substation on Price Road. Access driveway and internal circulation shall be approved by emergency services and public works for compliance with access requirements for emergency vehicles. As part of the development review committee process, the county fire marshal just wanted to make sure that the internal roads could handle emergency vehicles. Tied also with that is in the PUD, there's a requirement that FPL will coordinate with the county emergency management to make sure that there's adequate training, so should any emergencies be required to be addressed out there, county staff will know how to deal with them in that type of environment with electricity and the photovoltaic panels. The 25-foot native vegetative buffer around all wetlands. Lighting at this on-site substation will comply with Section 709 of the County Land Development Code, which requires all the lighting to be shielded and face down, limiting light pollution in the area. Findings and recommendation. Staff finds that the applicant has presented evidence that the rezoning to PUD is justified. The proposed rezoning and development is consistent with the future land use designation. The proposed project is compatible with the existing uses in the area. Development is consistent with the requirements of the PUD zoning and consistent with other comp plan goals, objectives, and policies. Planning Commission unanimously recommended approval of the rezoning to PUD at its November 9th meeting, subject to those changes that I've pointed out, and staff recommends approval of the request to rezone 207.7 plus minus acres of land from agriculture to planned unit development, subject to the inclusion of the Florida Power and Light Company Horizon 74.5 megawatt photovoltaic solar facility PUD development agreement. Staff is available for any questions from the board.
Board, is there any questions for Mr. Brown? Mr. Brown, I have a couple of seen nobody else. You were going to touch on the wildlife.
Oh, yes, I apologize.
That's okay.
Yes. This was a concern raised at the Planning Commission by some neighbors and other concerned citizens. And let me go back to the map. What FPL is committed to, when they submitted the application, there was security fencing around the perimeter of the property. they have committed, after discussion with some of the concerned citizens in the area, to pull back the security fencing from the perimeter of the property adjacent to Price Road, back to closer in to closer to the where the panels will actually occur. This will provide, especially on the east end in the Putnam County land, more room for movement of wildlife in the area. And that was a concern raised at by a few at the Planning Commission. Planning Commission agreed with that and included that in their recommendation.
Good. Commissioner Lible?
Mr. Brown, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Jurisdictionally, with Alachua and Putnam sharing this project, are they pursuing a PUD also? And do we coordinate?
Alachua is in the process. They have a different requirements than we do. We require a planned unit development. They don't require a planned unit development, but they require, I believe it's a special exception. So they're going through that process. They, I believe, are up for approval in December. Well, actually, it's the same time as your December board meeting. That's what it will be going to Alachua at that time.
You and our planning staff ever had this situation before where you're sharing a project over jurisdictional boundaries?
I have not, while I worked for Putnam County, but my previous life at the regional council, I had a number of large projects that worked in multiple jurisdictions and with multiple regional councils. The Putnam County portion of this project can move forward, whether Alachua approves theirs or not. Staff believes all our criteria are met. The entrance and substation is in Putnam County. So regardless of whether the Alachua County ever gets approved or built, if FPL just decided to do the portion in Putnam County, it could function, and staff believes it meets the criteria for the rezoning.
Very well. So that answers my question.
Are we going to be discussing the Coral Farms Road also?
Commissioner Goddard wanted to know if we were discussing Coral Farms, and that one's already
done. No, that one's already been approved by the board. That was approved by the board, I believe, in October.
Okay. Well, my only concern on that was you are going to take care of Price Road before and after, and I was just wondering if Coral Farms was addressed.
Right. That's just to let you know, that same condition was in that, and they have there's an agreement, a PUD agreement tied to that project, and they had that same condition for Coral Farms Road as this one. So
thank you very much.
And what's important about Price Road is we just paved it not too long ago. We're not actually completely done with the paving out there. So that's a concern of some of the citizens that live in that area. Okay, any other questions for Mr. Brown, commissioners? All right, thank you, Mr. Brown. Applicant, FP&L. We will let you come up if you will state your name.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, commissioners. My name is Jim Bush, and I'm a local manager with Florida Power and Light. With me today and also planning to speak is Jeff West from our solar planning group and Josh Long, our contracted planner for this project. In October, we presented the first of two solar projects that we have planned in Putnam County. That's the Coral Farms project near Flora Home. Today we're here to present our second project, which we call Horizon, and it's also located in West Putnam between Melrose and Hawthorne. As we did for our last, for the Coral Farms project, we'd like to just provide a short overview and then answer any questions that you may have. Before doing that, I'd first like to acknowledge the county planning staff for their assistance throughout the application process. They've been extremely helpful all along the way. And I'd also like to say that we at FPL are proud of our long-term relationship that we have with Putnam County. You may know us as the electric service provider of approximately 20,000 residents in Putnam County. What you may not know is that our sister company, NextEra Energy Resources, is a pioneer in utility scale solar. It's actually the world's largest generator of renewables from both the sun and the wind, most all of that being from outside the state of Florida. You want the presentation up there?
There it is.
Okay. You know, so this provides us with the unique opportunity to leverage that experience in bringing clean, renewable energy to Putnam County. FPL is committed to clean energy, which is important to us all. Just real quick on the background, since 2001, FPL has lowered carbon emissions by over 35%, while at the same time reducing dependence on foreign oil by over 99%. That's a great story. In addition, FPL already today meets the Environmental Protection Agency's clean power guidelines for the year 2030. Another great story, and something that's great for Florida and us as residents will all benefit from. Projects like this will allow us to continue to offset emissions and continue to move in the clean energy direction. We believe, along with our customers, that solar should play an increasing role in Florida's energy mix in the years ahead. Advancing solar in Florida is important to FPL's clean energy strategy. FPL first introduced solar back in the state in 2009, and this year we're on track to triple our capacity within Florida. The Horizon project, which we're here to discuss today, is another important step in continuing that commitment to clean energy and the environment. We're very excited about this project. We believe it's a great thing for the county, for the state, as well as for FPL. Now I'm going to hand it over to Josh Long, who has a few brief remarks.
Good morning. For the record, Josh Long, 777 South Flagler Drive, West Palm Beach, Florida. I am the project planner for this application. Also with me today is Stacy Ruiz, the attorney for the project. I'm an AICP planner with 15 years of experience. I'm going to be very brief. First, I want to thank Mike Brown and the staff for doing a very good job on the presentation and working with us on this project. Mike covered pretty much everything, so that's why I'm going to be very brief. But for the record, we do agree with his analysis, findings, and recommendations. In his online recommendation of approval, I did notice that he had recommended approval for a 207-acre project, when in fact it's actually 270, so that number was transposed. The 270 is correct in the PUD agreement and the development agreement, so I just wanted to bring that one little fact up. Now I'm going to turn it over to Jeff West with FPL. We are here if you have any questions. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions, Commission?
Okay. I'm good.
Mr. West?
Can I get the presentation back up? Good afternoon, Chairman and Commissioners, and congratulations on your new seats. As Josh mentioned, my name is Jeff West. I reside at 660 Sundown Circle in St. Augustine. I am a manager in the FPL Solar Development Group. As you've heard from Jim, my colleague, we're excited to present this project to you and to the members of your community as part of our efforts on advancing clean solar energy in Florida. The property we're talking about today, as Mike Brown already mentioned, is located between the town of Hawthorne and Melrose, just on the west side of Price Road, also known as County Road 1474. The project would use photovoltaic cells to convert the sun's energy to direct current. We use inverters then to ultimately convert that to alternating current or usable power, so the same power you would get at the your electrical socket. The project area consists of 271 acres. When we were looking for a potential site, we were looking for a site that was both cleared, flat, and close to our existing transmission line. This site fit all those criteria. It was used previously to grow hay, bahia grass, and it's going to be continued to harvest the sun's energy and contribute to the region. We purchased approximately 1,300 acres. This project, which straddles both Putnam and Alachua County, is approximately 684 acres total, 270 acres in Putnam County. We will continue to use the remaining property to license to farmers to grow hay and agriculture. The site just to give you some key facts, the site will generate enough energy equivalent to powering approximately 15,000 homes, and that's the total site. That same amount of power is equivalent to removing approximately 25,000 cars from the road annually, helping the state of Florida meet its emissions goal. Again, as Jen mentioned earlier, FPL is already cleaner than EPA's 2030 goal for Florida, and with 35% lower CO2 emissions compared to the national average. So as Jim mentioned, that's a great story for Florida. Unlike traditional power plants, our solar energy centers have no emissions and require no vertical construction like stacks or cooling towers. So there's minimal, if any, impacts to the surrounding area, and the solar panels themselves are silent. Because of their passive natures, these facilities are unmanned, being monitored remotely, and require very little maintenance. The photo you see is an aerial simulation of how the project would look once constructed. You can see the captions or the call-outs. You can see Price Road on the south end of the project, which wraps around to the east side of the project. You have the substation location. We are moving the, as you heard Mr. Brown state, we're moving the entrance to that location based on stakeholder input. You can see the internal access roads in between the actual panel arrays. The darker blocks are the panels themselves. And then the little square kind of grayish blocks are the inverters. So each inverter will convert approximately 1.8 to 2 megawatts of panels and convert that to alternating current. So there's approximately 40 inverters there that will convert electricity to alternating current, which will feed to our substation. The nice thing about having these inverters, some projects you've seen or you may have seen, use one larger inverter. And so if potentially the site, for some reason that inverter goes down, the whole site goes down. With this, if we lose one inverter, we're not losing the entire site. We have redundancy and efficiency built into the system with the inverters. So interestingly enough, the roads are the only disturbance to the land. We'll remove the top few inches of the soil, we'll lay down geotextile fabric, and then put gravel on top of that. The total area not covered by grass from the road construction is less than 5%. The panels and the racking systems, as you see in this slide, do not require any grading or concrete footers. The primary support channel, or the C channel, you see in the top left slide, will be driven approximately 10 feet into the ground. Then we come through and we add the vertical supports, followed by the horizontal supports in the top right portion of the slide. And then we install the panels themselves. And you can see there's in this configuration at our Manatee Solar Plant in South Florida, they're stacked by two. So they're approximately about 2 feet off the ground at the lowest point and up to about 6.5 to 7 feet tall at their highest point. And we maintain the ground as the natural vegetation there. In this case, it'll be bahia grass, and we'll mow that on a regular basis, approximately twice during the year, large mowing events, and then with maintenance mowing. So when we build these facilities, we expect to employ approximately 200 jobs over the 12-month building period. So that's 200 jobs locally sourced, and there will be quite a bit of on-the-job training occurring with these projects. Between Coral Farms and this project, we're looking at approximately 400 jobs. Ancillary services would be lodging, subcontractors used locally, and goods and services. So again, let me emphasize the significance of this construction technique, which we call kind of civil light. It's not only are we proposing to build a project consistent with the comprehensive plan, but we'd be doing it in the most minimally invasive way possible with the least impact to the wetlands and the natural environment. Now, while we strive to develop and design all of our projects in the least impactful way, I can't stand up here and take all the credit for it. We've had this project, we've had quite a bit of stakeholder input and considerable thoughtful input, which, you know, sometimes we don't always see certain design modifications that would help the project, but our neighbors and partners do. So I just wanted to outline some of the key dates we've had for reaching out to residents and stakeholders in the area. On July 6th, we had our first open house in Hawthorne for Alachua residents. Now that was a requirement by Alachua County for the special exception application, but we did have Putnam residents come out to that open house. August 12th, we met with some Putnam landowners that were not able to attend that workshop, and we met with them out on site, and we discussed adding vegetation screening to the prior entrance, and we created a simulation for that. I'll talk more about that in a second. We also discussed moving the fence back closer to the panels, and as Mr. Brown mentioned, that was to allow additional movement of wildlife in the area. As you can see from the simulation photo, we have quite a bit of open space on the project. So again, we're not impacting any wetlands, and we're minimizing the amount of vegetation that is being cleared. So there's very little vegetation that needs to be cleared. Like I said, the site was been used for growing bahia, grass, and hay. So on November 1st, we had an open house held at Interlochen Elementary for Putnam residents. There we received a number of comments regarding moving the project entrance, which was at the intersection of Baker Acres and Price Road, moving that to the substation location. The day after that open house, we also met with Chairman Harvey and the Lake Winnaut residents on site, and there we committed to moving the entrance to the substation, and we also committed to moving the fence closer to the panels, as well as moving some of the fencing across some of the existing agricultural ditches. So that leaves a gap underneath for wildlife movement. So that was another consideration. And then on November 9th, we had the Planning Commission meeting here. So again, we committed there to bringing Price Road to pre-construction condition or better within 4 months of completing construction. And we also committed to maintaining that road during the construction process. So here's the site plan that Mr. Brown also showed, and I have these kind of cloud callouts on the areas that we changed. So you'll see that in the southern end of the project, we've moved the fencing closer to the panels. We've also moved the entrance over to the substation. And in the northeastern portion of the project, we've also moved the fencing in. And one other thing that we've discussed and we've committed that came out of the open house, there is a local resident that is getting married on May 6th, and we've agreed not to disturb her wedding with any construction activity during that date. So just talking about the entrance to Baker Acres Road, we first approached the residents with a potential screening option for that entrance. And this shows you, the first top picture shows you what it currently looks like now. The bottom picture shows you what it would look like with the panels and the fencing in the background. It's kind of difficult to see those panels from this point of view. They're set back several hundred feet from that main entrance. We discussed with the residents potential planning a screening there that would lessen the visual impact of the project. And this shows you the screening that with the simulation, what that would look like. As we discussed more about moving the entrance to the substation location, the screening became less important. And that was something that was originally written into the development agreement. We've kind of changed that wording now. We're not going, at the wishes of the residents, we're not going to plant that right away. So within the first 6 months, we'll take a look at the site after it's been constructed, and if the residents still want the screening there, we'll put it in. But that's something that they've decided that they don't necessarily need the screening now that we've moved the entrance to the substation location. So I just wanted to point that out. So that's what I have for my presentation. At this point, I'd like to show a quick video, which basically takes some of these simulations and it shows you different views from the air, as well as from viewpoints along Price Road. Let me set that up for you real quick. Can you see that on your monitor? So this is the aerial view of the entire project. The county line pretty much runs right to the west side of that large kind of wetland complex in the central portion. So those are our panels, the inverters. These are the different viewpoints we simulated from Price Road. These are really the only publicly accessible spots, since there's a lot of existing vegetation around the project. So here they drop in the roads with the simulation, solar panels, substation location, and then the security fence. To make out the security fence and the panels right there. And again, you can see we've left quite a bit of open space in that portion of the project. Now we're going to be looking at the substation view from Price Road. And the solar panels, you can see the internal access roads that will be used for construction and service. And these are all gravel roads. That's the existing vegetation now that runs pretty much all along Price Road. We will have to clear about a 75-foot corridor for our transmission lines to come out. So this will be the most accessible spot to see the solar panels in the entire project area. The substation comes in, also the transmission line, and the fencing. Of course, our entrance will also be located at this location, so the corridor will be a little bit wider here, but the simulation was done prior to moving the entrance to this location. And out view of the site. Now, this was the previous entrance. There was an existing entrance there, farm entrance, for the hay operations. And this is Baker Acres Road that you see right here. We're actually standing on Baker Acres. This would have been the old entrance. The old location fence, and then this was the visual screening that we were going to put in. That was prior to moving the entrance. So now that entrance is going to stay basically the same. It's not, you know, as it is today. And the fence is going to be set back closer to the panel, so you probably won't even see the fence from that location because they're set back far enough. So, in conclusion, I just want to say that, you know, FPL loves solar, and we look forward to building on our existing relationship in Putnam County with both Coral Farms and this project. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Thank you. Mr. Lible.
Yes. Jeff, lighting. What can we expect? And if there is a intrusion on any of the neighbors, are you able to correct it?
Yeah, the facility itself will not have any lighting associated with it. The substation will have lighting, security lighting on it, three lights on the perimeter of the substation, and then one at the control building, and those will be shielded down.
Okay.
So we'll put shields on those lights to minimize the visual impact, but that will be the only lighting.
Mr. Stillwell?
Yes, sir. You said that there's haying has been going on the property, and that will continue?
That'll be continued right now on the portion of the property that's we don't have a project on. Like I said, we purchased, land was for sale. We purchased approximately 1,300 acres. We're using 684 acres for our solar project that straddles both Alachua and Putnam. The remaining land will be used. We'll license it to somebody to farm it for hay or cows or another, some other agriculture, whatever.
Okay, so that will just continue, kind of like it already is.
Yes.
The haying, and that'll be like during regular hours.
Yes, sir.
Normally. And it, just out of curiosity, how do you secure something this ultimately? I mean, you've got all these panels out there in the woods.
Yeah, so this, that's why we have the security fencing is really there for safety, and the National Electric Code requires us to have it protected and make sure that people can't access our panels. So that's a chain link fence with barbed wire on top. And that's been one of the issues with the stakeholders that live in and around the project is the kind of that visual impact of that fencing and the potential to impede wildlife movement. That's why we've set it back as close to the panels as possible to get it off of off the perimeter, and that will allow deer, turkey, and other wildlife to actually use the areas, those open spaces on the southeastern end of the property and the northeastern. And then we're also using the existing wetland system inside the project. So those, the drainage ditches and those large wetland complexes that we're not impacting for wildlife to move through as a kind of a smaller corridor, or small scale corridor to move through the project. And then again, we have the land to the west that will not be part of the project. So they'll still have the cattle fencing out there, but we're not adding any additional fencing to that portion of the property.
Right. And is this a real high maintenance, or is this, I mean, as far as you have to keep the panels clean and all, is that, do y'all contract that? Is that done in-house?
We use Mother Nature and what God has given us to clean those panels. So we use the rain.
You don't use a lot of chemicals
that's typical,
to clean panels or anything?
Right. So the rain is typically good enough to clean the panels. And then the mowing, like I said, occurs approximately twice, two large mowing events twice during the year. And then there'll be some maintenance mowing that occurs as well.
Okay. Well, very good.
Any other questions for Mr. Bush?
On the transmission line, looked like a real high line, and I've been under some of those in cow pastures before, and there's a noise coming from them. Does this have any noise?
The project itself, the panels and the inverters, when they're operating, emit a low humming sound that is pretty much inaudible from 50 to 150 feet away. And that is only when it's generating power. So obviously at night when there's no sun out, it won't be generating that sound. But again, from the boundary line and the property line, people should not be able to hear the panels and the inverters with that low humming sound.
All right. Any other questions, Commissioner? All right. Thank you, Mr. Webb. We appreciate it. We're going to go now to the interested parties for. And my first blue card is Mr. Brian Bergen with the Chamber of Commerce. Dana, would you like to come up with him? No? Okay. Thank you, Mr. Bergen.
Good morning and congratulations, commissioners, on your new seats. I'm sorry, I have a little bit of a cold, so I probably don't sound as good, if I ever sound good, as I usually do. I'm Brian Bergen, and I'm Vice President for Economic Development for the Putnam County Chamber of Commerce. One of the things I wanted to back up to was the coral farm projects. I know we talk a lot about jobs and economic development, and that actually has come to fruition. We are currently working with the contractor for FPNL. They contacted us, and they will indeed be hiring about 200 people to be working on the coral farms project. Us, in conjunction with CareerSource, are currently working with them to get those positions put into the system and people hired. They were looking for about 100 general laborers, and the rest of those will be a combination of electricians and skilled labor, as well as equipment operators to actually be on the site. So very good positions to have in the county for, you know, over a year. And then with the addition of the second project, having 200 more individuals is even more exciting. So I think that, you know, they've done a good job of actually stating their facts and living up to what they said they were going to do. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bergen. Any questions for Mr. Bergen? All right, thank you, Mr. Bergen. We appreciate it. Our next blue card is Ms. Debbie Griffin. Morning, Ms. Griffin.
Good morning, Commissioner. Chairman Harvey, that has a nice ring to it. Very happy to say that. And congratulations to the new incoming commissioners and to Mr. Leibel. Nice to see you again. My husband and I are here today to speak in favor of FPL. We are not a part of the Hawthorne consideration, but we are part of the Coral Farms project. And we would like everyone to know that FPL has been as good as their word. They assured us that they would work with us, they would be cooperative. We did not need a contract in order to accomplish this, and they have indeed been as good as their word. They've been very honorable, and they presented something to us that's far greater than a contract, because a contract, as you know, can be disputed. But when someone gives you their word, that is indisputable, and they have been as good as their word. They've been great to work with. We hope that the people in Hawthorne, if you decide to approve this, will find them to be the same. We have found them to be very honorable, and we have enjoyed working with them. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Griffin. Thank you. Next speaker will be Mr. Howard Griffin. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Good morning, Mr. Chairman, commissioners all. Congratulations to everyone. We're happy to see you here, and we appreciate your service to the county. I, along with Debbie, I'm Howard Griffin, live 1710 Bellamy Road, Keystone Heights, Florida. We own the property just north of the Coral Farms facility, and I realize you're not here to discuss Coral Farms, but I think it's extremely important to know that you're still dealing with the same company and dealing with the same team. The time that, you know, just recently I was standing at this podium railing about the fact that it appeared as though their right-of-way was going to crush our plans. We were halfway through, and we are halfway through, a three-year lease purchase agreement with a family farm, a dairy operation that we had agreed to sell our property to over time to grow their feed while they're growing their cattle herd or their milking herd. Currently, they're at 66% of their projected 1,800 head. Whenever they finish this, they will be employing 50 people in our area, which is huge for us. And not only is it huge for us in our area for the families involved, but it's great for us as Debbie and Howard, and also with Jim and Ellie with their thing. The team that FPL has put out there working with us, I could not ask for a better team. I didn't ask for this team. Fate sort of threw us together, but I think both sides have really made the best of a haphazard situation as to how we got together. Meyer, Dan, Jim, Jeff, Kelly, you name all the people that's involved with this and are responsible for this very successful union here, we appreciate greatly, because they had the rights to come through and really wreak havoc with our whole farming operation. If they would have done what they could have done if they had won the lawsuit, they could have really wreaked havoc with us. All of that's gone. All of that's waylaid. It was never about money. It's still not about money. And they haven't paid us off to do this. They have worked with us, and they've remained at the table. They haven't turned their back on us. They haven't used the nuclear option on us. We're pretty happy. And you folks, I'd appreciate you giving them all the concern you could, because they have shown us a side of FPL and this team that we really appreciate greatly. They just, it was at the point where they could have really hurt us. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Griffin.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right, is there anybody in the audience that would like to speak in favor of this applicant? Please come up and state your name and address.
Good morning. My name is Chris Kublock. I reside at 189 Spring Park Avenue in Ponte Vedra, Florida. I wanted to just take a couple minutes to talk about the impact when we're talking about hiring 200 people to a local community. I work for a company called Aerotech. We're a staffing and recruiting company, the largest in the country, and we specialize on the energy side. So I work with companies such as Florida Power and Light and help them identify the top local talent in communities when we're talking about building projects such as these. We have employed, I know Mr. Bryan with the chamber mentioned earlier, 100 general laborers. I've seen youth that didn't really have much direction in their life, who we've put to work and have actually learned a trade and then turned it into a career and kind of taken that to the next step and found permanent positions, and now they're traveling with companies and building these farms all over the country. So, I mean, it's a significant impact to the community and the local residents here. So I just wanted to throw my two cents in. So,
well, thank you.
I appreciate that.
Any questions? All right. Thank you,
good.
Sir.
Thank you for your comments.
All right. Anybody else want to speak in favor of this applicant? All right. Anybody opposed to this applicant would like to speak? Miss.
Faye Sparkman, 103 Flamingo Boulevard, Interlaken. I'm not opposed or either way. The questions we have is, how much is it going to affect us on FP&L's bills, considering we're on fixed incomes? How much is our bills going to go up? And are they going to have to pay taxes on this property to Putnam County to earn money? The other question is, when they're finished with construction, how many jobs are we going to have left? Yes, we need jobs in this county, but we also need answers on what it's going to do to us.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Bartman. I'll give rebuttals, FP&L. Would you like to come up and answer any questions or rebut?
Sure, thank you. Thank you for those comments. Again, Jeff West. So I think she had 3 points. Taxes, jobs after the fact. What was the third one?
How much will the bill go up or down?
Okay. So these projects, first of all, these projects we have to prove to we're a regulated utility, so we have to prove to the Public Service Commission that these are cost-effective projects. So that means the savings from the fuel costs over the life of the project have to be greater than the capital cost to build a project. So we have to show the Public Service Commission that the fuel cost savings over the life of the project are greater than the cost to build the project. So this project meets that cost-effective test, and we share that information with the Public Service Commission. So their rates, they'll actually, over the life of the project, they'll see savings on their rates from this project. In terms of taxes, but changing the land use, we're already going to increase the amount that the county is going to receive in taxes. It was prior agricultural use, which ag received certain exemptions, and we're changing it to PUD. So just in that respect, the taxes will go up for this property. There was a legislation amendment 4 that was voted on in August that does exempt commercial solar from certain taxes, from ad valorem taxes. That still hasn't been written in the legislature yet, and we're hearing different things from the legislature of what will actually be exempted or not. So we'll be watching that to see, what kind of items would be exempted. But, in some cases, solar panels and the inverters, but not necessarily the substation, transmission, and any other improvements to the project itself. And then lastly, with jobs, as you heard Mr. Bergeron say, 200 jobs during the construction. So with 2 projects, that's about 400 jobs. We expect after these projects are constructed, there'll be people out there, technicians doing some work on maintenance. Your panel goes down or inverter goes down, we'll have technicians out there. We assume per project about 1 full-time employee per project in the area. So that's, with 2 projects, we're looking at potentially maybe 2 full-time equivalent employees working here in Putnam County, and that would add to our existing 30 employees that we have currently working at the service center. So and that doesn't include vegetation management, so we'll have contractors out mowing the sites, and those will be most likely local contractors that will be mowing the sites.
All right.
Thank you.
Any questions? All right. This will be the close of our formal proceedings. And is there any last public input that anybody would like to give us? All right, seeing none, we'll close our public hearing, deliberations, and voting. Commissioners, any thoughts?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to take action, bring on the amendment for the county zoning map, 270.7 acres from ag to PUD. I think that's all I need to say. Staff recommendations.
All right, thank you. We have a proper motion. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
All right, we have a proper second. All in favor say aye. Aye.
Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Motion carries. Thank you very much. All right. Next item of business, Mr. Leary, do you want to go over these appointments that we have?
Well, so we've listed the appointments that are pending. I really think we've listed these mostly for information, sir. I don't know that we really expect you to make any of these appointments today. I don't see that there's any real sense of urgency about any of these. The only one I really don't know about, sir, is the Northeast Florida Regional Council. I don't know whether there's a meeting of that particular group prior to your next meeting on December the 13th. You're on that council. Do you meet again before the
13th? Yes, sir, we do.
Okay. So there is one vacancy, I guess, created by virtue of Mr. Peller Sears leaving office. So I don't know whether you want to address that one or not, but among the other ones that are listed here, I don't know that there's any real sense of urgency about any of them. So board's prerogative to either make appointments or defer until your next meeting.
Okay, well, thank you. All right. Does any commissioners, you've probably had some time to look over this, but does anybody have any appointments they would like to make? Starting to my right, Mr. Lible.
I have none at this time.
Mr. Goddard.
Can I volunteer for this?
You can.
Then I'll volunteer for it.
All right. So you would like to serve at the Northeast Florida Regional Council instead of Walton Palisier?
Correct.
Okay. We'll do all these in one big motion, and would that be all right? Is that okay, Mr. Lear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mr. Stillwell, do you have any appointments you'd like to make?
Well, I'd like to just, if you give me a little bit more time to look at them, I do have looked at a couple of them that were local. I think one was like this in sanitation. I just put this up. I had it out. But there is a couple, if you can just give me a little time, that I do want to.
We can take as much time as you need. Mr. Pickens?
On the Better Place Plan Oversight Committee, to replace me, District 1, can I make a recommendation on that?
Yes, sir. Please do.
Mr. Stuart Ryder.
Stuart Ryder.
Crescent City.
Good choice. All right. So as of right now, we have two appointments, and we'll come back to the rest of them at a later date. Better Place Plan, District 1, replacing Bill Pickens with Stuart Ryder. And on page 2, Northeast Florida Regional Council, replacing Walton Palisier with Buddy Goddard. I will entertain a motion.
I'll make that motion.
All second. Right. We have a proper motion and a proper second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, like sign. Motion carries. Item number 10, County Administrator, Mr. Rick Leary.
Thank you, sir. We would like to take the opportunity sometime at the board's convenience to schedule a little orientation whereby department heads could meet in the conference room one at a time with members of the with the board, particularly with the new members, and of course we invite older members of the board to sit in if they so choose, so that department heads could present to you a little presentation about their mission and familiarize you with their workload, and knowing in future that you'll want to actually visit in their environment, but at least give you an opportunity to get some familiarization with what their activity level is and their function, perhaps prior to your next meeting, regular meeting here on December the 13th. We know you have some obligations next week that you will be fulfilling, so we would like to suggest that maybe we could do that sometime in the week of December the 5th. That will probably take about a day and a half to accomplish that. We will schedule department heads at 30-minute to an hour interval. So if you could give us a couple of days, if you would look at your calendars maybe and see what 2 days consecutively during that week might be good for you to do that. We'll certainly schedule them at your convenience.
Members, do you have your calendars with you? I have Tuesday the 6th would be a great day, and Wednesday the 7th. Is that trying to keep everything on a Tuesday? Is that good, bad, indifferent? Or is there other dates that you'd like to look at?
I would have to look at other dates.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, why don't you let them have a couple hours to get their planners together and then bring the suggestions to our workshop.
That's a great idea, Mr. Lible. We'll bring those dates back at our workshop today.
They really need to look at them.
We'll spend a few minutes before our meeting at 2 o'clock to go over that. All right, Mr. Leary, is there anything else?
Yes, sir, I do have one other thing. You'll recall that subsequent to the to Hurricane Matthew, the board acted to affirm the administrative waiver that we had granted at the landfill to waive the tipping fees for storm-related debris and construction and demolition material. And since the construction contractor will begin making the second pass throughout the county to pick up debris beginning November 28th, we think it would be appropriate for you to extend that tipping fee waiver for an additional 30 days. So we would ask you to approve that, sir.
Okay. Board will entertain a motion.
Move approval.
All right. Do we get a second?
I'll second.
All in favor say aye. Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, like sign. Good. Motion carries. Mr. Leary, you still have the floor?
I have nothing else, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Manning, our county attorney.
Just briefly, I just want to congratulate all of our new board members. I'm excited to work with you. And just to let you know that I'm available if you have questions on the Sunshine Law or public records or ethics questions. If you have anything that you see on the agenda that's coming up of a legal nature that you would like to discuss, I'll be more than happy to discuss that with you to kind of fill you in before we get to the meeting. It's sometimes helpful to do that ahead of time. And just let you all know that my door is always open, and I'm here for you to the extent I can be.
Thank you, Mr. Manning. Mr. Smith, our clerk of the court.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have no items today, but I would like to be included in the orientation process that the county administrator sets up with you to share with you the role that I have as your comptroller and clerk to the board.
We'll make sure that happens. Thank you, sir. Commissioner comments. We'll start to my left. Mr. Pickens, do you have any comments you'd like to make?
Well, I've enjoyed my first meeting. It's been too eventful. I would like to make a comment about Florida Power and Light, and from meeting with them yesterday and their presentation, it's a good corporate citizen to have, and looks like they're doing everything to improve Putnam County, supply the jobs for a limited number of time, but you know, eliminate the emissions that are put out with power production. So, and just honored to be a county commissioner and look forward to the rest of the year.
Good. Thank you. Mr. Stillwell?
Yeah, I'd like to thank everybody that's been involved for this. It wasn't near as bad as what I thought it was going to be, so it's all good. I appreciate
anyway.
It. But I agree with Mr. Pickens with Florida Power and Light. I think anything we do to move forward in the county is good for us, and I look forward to the next 4 years.
Good, thank you. Mr. Lible, all the way to my right.
All right. It's been a great year as chairman. We did a lot of exciting things. One of the biggest challenges we had was the county mowing, and with that, we had some changes at Public Works. Mr. Press Tompkins has brought some additional ideas that got our own mowing crew, and I think we're not perfect, but we're getting there. And Mr. Mike Nimitz, in the interim, you did a great job. I appreciate that. Sheriff-elect Deloach, I really look forward to working with you in the forward
on the animal control issues. It looks like we're going to be building a new facility, and I hope that we can start a vet tech program for our inmates that will help with our labor and of course, our adoptions is very important. We really got the ball rolling this year, and I'm proud of that. And the fact that we built a jail, that's not something I like to brag about, but you know, we wanted to keep our deputies safe, and I know the other one was falling apart, and we had issues, and you and Joe Wells, I thank you, and I look forward to working with you. Other than that, feels great to sit over here on the right and not have all those duties. Chairman Harvey, I wish you well this coming year, and I think we have a good team here. I really do, and we have a lot of challenges, and I think that a lot of groundwork that's been laid over the last 2 years with our infrastructure, both water and sewer and these sort of things, we will see the dividends in the coming years. The next 2 years are going to be very exciting for this county, and you're going to be a major part of that. And thank you, and welcome aboard.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Goddard?
Yeah. I want to say thank you, everyone, because we've got to work together. That's the most important thing. We need your input. We need your eyes out there seeing what we can't see. And I do believe our relationship with FPNL is going to be very good. They've always been good with us in the past. I know a lot of people that work there. And this has been quite an adventure, and I'm very touched. I really appreciate the kindness that everyone has showed us. Thank you.
Thank you. And let me just close by saying it's an honor and a privilege to sit in this seat. Chairman Lible, you did it very well.
I left a very important person out of my thank yous.
Go right ahead, finish
well,
it
Well, two. Mr. Manning's new, yes. And I just realized that, and quite capable. I'm excited.
Right.
It's been great working with you. And my wife, she puts up with all this constantly. She's in the audience. Elizabeth, thank you publicly today for all you do.
Yeah.
Mr. Chairman, that's all.
You know, you're exactly right. Our families are the ones that suffer the most.
Oh, boy.
And those commissioners that are still in the audience can attest to that. You know, we go home and we have to talk to somebody, and they're the ones that get it. And sometimes they get very upset, but you know, it's our job to be in the public eye and to represent you. It's a privilege and honor to represent over 73,000 people in this county, and we are all committed to move forward. We are individuals that make up a team, and I expect nothing less than preparation and cooperation and moving this county forward. You know, back when I was younger and worked in this same building, I was thinking of Ms. Gilliard's statement this morning. Imagine a young man walking out bagging groceries and carrying groceries to people's car, thinking, Lord, what am I going to do for the rest of my life? And now I'm back in that same plaza. And it's humbling to be sitting here. It was humbling to be appointed. It was humbling to be elected. And it's more humbling to be sitting here as your chairman. So thank you very much, commissioners. I look forward to it. We will adjourn our meeting and meet back up at 2:00 at our transportation meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.